rose-colored glasses are off, it's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 36 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I had the pleasure of chatting with none other than AMI's Drew McLellan. Drew has worked in advertising for 25 years and started his own agency, McLellan Marketing Group, in 1995 after a five-year stint at Y&R and still actively runs the agency. He also owns and runs Agency Management Institute, or AMI, which serves 250-plus small to mid-sized businesses every year in advertising, digital marketing, media, and PR, so that they can increase their AGI, attract better clients and employees, mitigate the risk of being self-employed in such a volatile business, and best of all, let the agency owners actually enjoy the perks of agency ownership. Drew often appears in publications like Entrepreneur Magazine, New York Times, Washington Post, Agency Post, AdAge, CNN, BusinessWeek, and many others. The Wall Street Journal calls him one of the 10 bloggers every entrepreneur should read. When he's not hanging out with clients or agency owners and their staff, Drew spends time with his daughter and pondering why the Dodgers can't seem to make it back to the World Series. Drew has a master's degree from the University of Minnesota, but alas, cannot remember their fight song. So without further ado, let's hop into our interview with Drew McLellan. Drew, thanks so much for chatting with me.
Oh, it's great to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Yes, I am a really big fan of yours. I heard you first on the Social Pros podcast. Almost 2 years ago, you had just came out with an Agency Management Institute report on why agencies get fired so often. And I've been an avid listener to your Build a Better Agency podcast ever since. And your core competency is marketing. So it's always good to chat with a seasoned vet who's been through several stages, but it wasn't always that way. You weren't always doing Agency Management Institute. Everyone has to start somewhere. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug and how did you become enchanted with marketing?
Yeah. So I was in college and I was a psych major. Long story short, my advisor said to me, what do you want to do with this? And I said, I want to be a therapist. And he said, you know, I've had, you know, several of my classes and I think that that would be a tough profession for you. I think it would be hard for you to leave it at the office. You seem to be the kind of guy who likes to pick up stray puppies and try and find homes for them. And he said, in therapy, you really need to be able to build this brick wall between you and the patient so that you don't carry their burdens with you. And so I was like, crap, I'm, you know, almost halfway through my college career. Now what? So I said, let me think about that over the weekend. And I went home and chatted with my parents about it and they could sort of see his point and it got me thinking. And so I went back and I said to him, okay, look, here are the classes I've taken. What else can I do? And he said, you know, you've got a lot of writing classes. You have a lot of English classes. You obviously have a lot of psych classes. Talk to me a little bit about that. And I said, you know, I love to write and I love to tell stories and I'm fascinated by why people do things. And he said, have you ever thought about advertising and marketing? And I honestly, at that point, hadn't. And so he sent me over to the head of that department and I spent some time with that person. And all of a sudden it was just like something clicked and it was like, here's how I can use all of my talents in a way that I had never thought of before. So I changed majors. And while I was working in my undergrad, one of my adjunct professors was the creative director at Gray Advertising in Minneapolis. And she offered me an opportunity to freelance. And I literally have worked for agencies ever since. So got my graduate degree, just kept going and finished my master's degree. And then I got a job at Y&R. Did that for a few years. And that was on the East Coast. And I wanted to get back to the Midwest, which is where my family was. And so I took a job at a regional shop. And in 1995, I was sort of that perfect age of ignorant and arrogant. So I was 30 years old and I thought, how hard can it be to run an agency? And so I launched out on my own and learned very quickly how hard it is to run an agency. So fast forward 20 some years later, I still own that agency and still am active in running it. And about a decade ago, I took over ownership of Agency Management Institute. So now I split my time between being an agency owner and doing the same kind of things that all agency owners do, and coaching and counseling other agency owners and helping them build a better, stronger, more profitable business.
I love that. I love that you have a background in psychology and the humanities, because my co-author, she actually has an undergraduate in behavior analysis. So she took kind of very much the same route. And I love that phrase you said, the perfect mix of ignorant and arrogant, because you have to be a little bit of both to jump into this world. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that sort of shiny veneer come off? And it's like, okay, it's time to get down to brass tacks. Kind of like marriage, right? When you first get into it, everything's new and different. Then you figure out that this person snores like a dying moose. And now it's just time to get down to business. So when was that sort of wake up moment for you in Agency Management Institute and running your own shop?
So, you know, on the agency side, it happened pretty quickly, because all of a sudden I was really good at the front end, the client serving side of the business, but I had no idea what the heck I was doing in terms of running a business. So I had to learn that very quickly. And so that was a harsh reality for me. You know, and on the Agency Management Institute side, knock on wood, the disenchantment for me comes in us not being able to do all the things that are in my head that I want to do, and trying to stay super disciplined. And, you know, I mean, that's sort of a marketing truism, isn't it? That infinite opportunities and ideas, but you only have finite resources. And so you have to spend them well and wisely. And, you know, I still struggle with that. I want to be doing everything. So, you know, I have to say, I can't imagine doing anything else. So I'm not really disenchanted, but I certainly know that it's basically a lot of hard work and discipline, and it's not as sexy as, you know, the television shows or movies portray our business to be.
Absolutely. And amen to that. That's why I named this podcast Marketing Disenchanted, because, you know, I was that rube. I fell head over heels and I was into it. And then I got a peek behind the curtain and it was like, you know, it was a little bit of a, you know, cold water on the face moment. So thanks so much for sharing. So you're a man of a certain age. You have a lot of experience. If you had a time machine and you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I watch Doctor Who.
Me too.
Shout out to Peter Capaldi. What are the top three things that you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
First of all, I'm a David Tennant man myself, but okay. I look back at my career and I look back at everything that I've learned. And I think I would encourage myself to recognize that there is no complacency in marketing, that no matter what you know today, you're going to have to know something different tomorrow. And so the best way to guide and teach others is to be a constant student. So that's, you know, reading books, you know, listening to podcasts, which of course didn't exist back when I was younger. And also to seek out other people who do what I do, to spend time with them and learn how they do it. One of the things that's very true, I think, about marketing is there is no one right answer. And so the more options and ideas you can expose yourself to, the better odds you have of finding the one that is going to be right for this particular situation. So one would keep learning. Two, that there is no one right answer. And three, that it's really all a big experiment, that you're never done. It's never one and done. But you, in marketing, it's constant tweaking and constant adjusting to, you know, as you watch how the marketplace reacts, as you watch how consumers react, as you watch how the employees within an organization react to something you're doing, there's always a little bit of tweaking that needs to happen. And so you have to be a tinkerer. You have to be willing to go, well, I wonder if I turn this dial a little more, or I wonder if I flip this lever instead of that lever. So you can't be content in the work, that you have to keep trying to make incremental improvements. I guess those are the three things I sure didn't know when I was coming right out of school.
Yes, indeed. So now I'm going to actually look into the future a little bit, because one of the areas of marketing that I focus on is mobile/connected devices/Internet of Things, whatever you want to call it. And sort of the default example that everyone gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list, which is then delivered to you via Amazon drone. And in that example, it's what they call a closed loop system because you don't actually have to leave the house. It's sort of like the Jetsons. But the milk has to get in there in the first place. So how do you see the role of marketing evolving once we get to a level of automation to where, you know, it's like we're living in the Jetsons.
Yeah. My issue with the whole fridge example is, what if you're going out of town and you're going to be gone for 2 weeks and you don't want milk in the fridge? So I think there's plenty of room still for human interaction. And I guess that to me is what the future, we as people get so excited about the shiny new object, whatever it is. You know, to your point, I am a man of a certain age. I'm 53, and early in my career, you know, the internet was not something we dealt with every day. And certainly every business in the world didn't have a website. And when all of that came to be, it was, you know, the predictions were that, you know, all other mediums were going to go away. And this was going to be, you know, this was going to change our lives forever. And no doubt it has changed our life. But the reality is, human beings are still at the core of it. And they still make the decision in terms of how to use the tools that are in front of them. The tools change, but the human beings still decide how they want to weave those into their lives. And so I think in some ways, marketing at its core, which is really connecting with the audience and understanding them well enough to know that you are or are not the right solution for them. And I think a big part of marketing is helping people decide that you're not the right solution for them, so you don't have a bunch of disenfranchised buyers out there. So I think in a lot of ways, marketing will be about, will we use different techniques and technology and tools? Absolutely. But at the end of the day, it is still about the human connection and how can I make your life better? And if I can't do that, if I can't remove a worry, if I can't enhance an experience, if I can't give you a convenience you don't have today, if I can't save you money, if I can't hit one of those sort of core human desires, you know, whether I'm talking to you in a newspaper ad in the 1950s, or I'm talking to you through a little advertising screen on your refrigerator, which they're also talking about, it doesn't really matter. And so I think the trick for the future is not to get so enamored with the tools that we forget our core purpose.
Yes, indeed. I couldn't agree more. There's this nasty tendency in digital marketing to sort of throw the baby out with the bathwater and say that X is going to kill Y, and, you know, this is going to kill off that. And certainly, you know, certain verticals aren't in the best shape, like newspapers, but, you know, print still exists and print is still very powerful. It's always good to take a step back. One of my former guests, Brian Fanzo, he says he's a proud pager wearing millennial. And I'm only a couple years younger than Brian, but I'm a fan of the fundamentals as well, because it's like, you know, tactics change, but principles don't. So right. I can't agree with that more. So you, Brian Solis, John Jantz, or, you know, whomever, Brian Fanzo, you're all sitting at the after a conference having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the present digital marketing industry, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
I think what's lacking is a couple of things. One, a deep understanding of how the tools work and how they're used. I think there are a lot of posers out there who are, you know, taking a couple online classes and then purporting that they know how to make these tools work for clients. And I don't think that's the case. And two, I think there's still too many people who are taking the set it and forget. So, you know, in the good old days, with air quotes, when you bought, say, a radio or television schedule, you would buy it for 13 or 26 weeks. And once you bought it, it ran, and that was it. You didn't every day, you didn't change what shows your commercials were on or anything like that. You just ran the schedule. You know, if something big happened, you might make an adjustment. But for the most part, it was really set it and forget it. And I think a lot of people still bring that mentality to the digital world. So I think that's another problem that people need to understand, that it's constant evolution. And then quite honestly, I think part of it is on the client side. You know, a lot of clients are, for a lot of businesses, a lot of clients are still kind of old school marketers. And so they're used to the old traditional ways of buying media. And so they struggle with understanding the incredible amount of labor and intelligence it takes to really deploy and, you know, maximize a digital campaign of any kind, whether it's social or, you know, programmatic or whatever it may be. And so they really push back. Agencies are struggling to get paid appropriately for the amount of time it takes. And so, you know, I think it's a generational shift. I think those marketing, those CMOs, for example, who are in their 50s are sort of the last of sort of the dying breed of people who were not digital natives, who don't really understand how long it takes to do it and do it right and well. So I think a lot of it is about education, about helping people understand really what our best practices. And, you know, we love the quick tweet. We love the 10 best things lists. We love all of these little soundbite things. But the reality is, and this gets back to what I was saying earlier, the reality is that this requires a very sophisticated education. And you're not going to get it in a tweet or in an ebook or in some other bite-sized consumable piece of content. You're going to have to really dig in and learn it. And so in doing so, then we're better equipped to educate clients about the realities of digital and the time it takes to really do it well. And, you know, the other thing that is part of digital is digital changes every day. And we're not used to that either. We're used to, you know, this is how we buy fill in the blank media. And it's been that way for 5, 10, 15, 20, 30 years. But digital is literally evolving before our eyes. And so, again, you can't take your eye off the ball and you can't assume that what you knew yesterday is good enough for today.
Amen, brother. You are preaching to the choir and I'm loving every minute of it because everybody's got the buzzwords, but few people do it well. And it's easy to sort of get grandiose and like to your point, you have a lot of posers, but when it comes time to actually execute against that, it can become very humbling. So we are going to take a short break. And then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Mr. Drew McLellan. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it, hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And And we're back. So, Drew, last year, myself and my co-author, we wrote a book called Beyond Buzzwords. And by far, the buzzword of 2016 was influencer marketing.
Yeah.
Jay Baer over at Convince and Convert, he even launched a podcast called Influence Pros. And those in the space warned that it was only a matter of time before we got our first spectacular train wreck. Not a regular train wreck, but a spectacular train wreck. I'm talking mushroom cloud, debris everywhere, which we just got courtesy of one PewDiePie. So for those who don't know, PewDiePie is the like sort of first rags to riches YouTube success story. He was the first YouTube channel with a billion, that's a billion with a B, views. He makes about $4 million a year from his channel, and he previously had relationships with Disney and Maker. And the reason I say previously is because PewDiePie fashions himself as sort of an amateur humorist, and he decided to take shots at the site Fiverr and the outrageous things you can get people to do for as little as $5. The problem is the way in which he went about this is that he paid people on Fiverr to do anti-Semitic things, which I won't repeat on the show. And so, you know, the backlash was swift and immediate. And so my question to you is two parts. How do you see this fiasco affecting influencer marketing as a whole? Because Disney has actually received a fair amount of backlash for abandoning PewDiePie. And on the Marketing Companion podcast by Mark Schaefer and Tom Webster, Chris Brogan actually made the point that the way that digital natives use language is fundamentally different from the way that you and I use language. And what offends them doesn't necessarily offend us. And part two is, in this sort of salacious, clickbaity internet that we find ourselves in, the trend has been toward the ever more outrageous. And so do you think that this will embolden those looking to, you know, make a name for themselves in the influencer marketing space, or do you think it'll have a chilling effect?
Yeah, here's what I love about this question. It could be 1963, and we could be talking about a radio spokesperson who, on their own time, got drunk and slapped their spouse or whatever. The reality is, when you attach your brand to a spokesperson, whether it's old school and they're in your TV spots, or it's the new version, which is influencer marketing. Basically, you have to remember that these are not marketing people, number one. Number two, these are amateurs who have created a platform for themselves, whether they're a movie star or they're a YouTube sensation or they are a foodie blogger or whatever. So they've created a platform and a assumed expertise in something, which has earned them a high profile. But they're still human beings, and they are still prone to behave like human beings. And so in many cases, that's great. And in other cases, you know, as the example you gave, that's great. And so it's always been a risk to ask someone else to speak for your brand. So in some ways, what is new is old, and what is old is new again. So first of all, that. Secondly, when you are the keeper of a brand, when I was a kid, my mom used to always say to me, choose your friends wisely, because you are judged by who you hang out with. And that's very true for a brand as well. So, you know, when you're a brand like Disney, which is known for wholesome and family and all of those things, I get that you want to attract millennials. And I get, and I think Chris is right. I think that the, you know, 30 and under generation uses language and humor very differently. I mean, if you watch most of the sort of adult level animated humor that's on TV today, you can see that it's a very different sensitivity or lack thereof of political correctness and of the things that are said about other people. And there's no offense taken. It's meant to be funny, and they take it as it's funny. And, you know, but if somebody who's 65 watches those shows, you know, they're appalled. So I think you have to know your brand, and I think you have to understand who your audience is and what your audience's tolerance is for that sort of thing. And so, you know, I get that Disney wants the millennial audience, but they have to tread differently than, you know, a brand that is all about the millennials. Because Disney's not. Disney is a multi-generational brand. And so they can't live on the edge like a, you know, hipster brand can. So again, I hate to sound like a broken record, but again, this is an old problem that is just showing up in new ways. And I think we're going to see plenty more of these issues, just like we have always seen when you attach a flawed human being to a brand. Sometimes that human being behaves miraculously well and is a great spokesperson and really honors the brand. And sometimes they do either stupid things or they do things that advance their agenda and they don't really care how it affects the brand. And it sounds to me like in this case, you know, he's not getting a billion views because he stays in the safe zone. He's getting a billion views because he's edgy and he's willing to take risks. And everybody who associated their brand with him should have known that and made that conscious decision.
Yes, indeed. Even a few years ago, you can go back to Tiger Woods, right? Tiger Woods was a golden boy of golf.
Right.
Turns out he, you know, can't keep it in his pants and Nike had to run for the hill. So true story. So without getting political, you know, to the best of your ability, but by all means, express yourself because candor is the whole point of the podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news controversy slash response by Facebook? And for those who don't know, because every podcast is somebody's first podcast, in the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news began to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, I mean these stories were wholesale fabricated, had no factual basis in reality. It was not a simple matter of spinning the facts one way or another, which all news does. There were no underlying facts to be spun. And afterwards, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off and he was like, oh, no. It's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the outcome. But then in his open letter in February, he conceded that fake news has outstripped Facebook's current capacity to govern it. And they are in the process of rolling out AI, which is artificial intelligence, and other third party means to sort of verify and tackle that problem. And so this has sparked a very interesting debate in the marketing community because you have some people who are strictly First Amendment. They're like, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. And they should just let people say, you know, what they want to say. And then you have others who are like, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you're away on business and some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool and one of them drowns. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. Doesn't matter. It happened on your property and you are responsible. So again, without getting political to the best of your ability, on the marketing side of things, where do you stand on this whole fake news governance debate?
Yeah, I think this is one of the harsher realities of everyone has access to the tools. So, you know, I can remember back early in the SEO days that people who hated brands would buy up all the URLs like, you know, Pepsi sucks and, you know, PepsiCausesCancer.com and, you know, all of those kind of things. And then they would publish content that was disparaging against the brand. And this is sort of just a new version of that, which is basically when every numbskull in the world can publish a website or create with simple layout software, something that looks like a news site. The reality is a couple things. One, human beings come in a wide variety of shapes, sizes, intellect levels, and intentions. And there have always been people who have wanted to take advantage of a situation or a moment in time and capitalize on it either financially or to drive an agenda. And so I think that's what we're seeing here is that people have the tools and they can make crap up and they do, and that they gain something, whether it's money or, you know, political opinion or whatever it may be, but they're winning the game every time we click on that stuff. So I think this is not a new problem. I just think it's a new version of the problem. I think the challenge is that you've got all of these sites, and it's not just Facebook, but all of these sites that in essence are all the content is crowdsourced. So, you know, whatever my friends, my Facebook friends put on Facebook for the most part is what I'm going to see, right? And so it's sort of like asking one chaperone to watch 50,000 kids, at a museum and make sure they don't touch anything. Pretty tough. And so do I think Facebook has a responsibility to try and regulate to a certain extent what goes on their platform? Yeah, just like if, you know, if you see an ad that's offensive or someone sends you something that's spam, you can report them. But I don't think it's possible for them to really manage the volume that runs through their pipe every day. And B, I don't think it's just their responsibility. I think they have some responsibility, but I think we all have a certain amount of responsibility, because it's not just that it shows up in my newsfeed, but it's that I click on it, or I share it, or I comment on it. So I'm fanning the flames as a user if I react to that as well. I'm sure there will come a time where somehow that stuff is flagged or marked differently, or it's marked as entertainment or something. But today, I think it's just a big cluster. And I think in this political environment, in this divisive political environment that we live in today, regardless of which side of the fence that you fall on, it just is exasperated, because everybody, there seems to be no one in the middle anymore. Everybody is sort of polar opposite, and everybody hates whoever's not on the same side of the fence as they are. And so the culturally and societal-wise, environment is ripe for this sort of thing. And I can't really say I think it's Facebook's responsibility to clean it all up, because, you know, I think we have some responsibility in that as well.
Indeed, it is quite the pickle. So I'm particularly interested in your response to this next question, because large corporations have just recently really started to throw their weight behind digital marketing. And by that, I mean, just as recently as, you know, 5-6 years ago, some of these larger brands like Coca-Cola or whatever, they didn't even have a job description, and now they have an entire department. And so as what's been happening is that the lion's share of this media spend has been going to Facebook and Google. Like, it's not even close. And they're getting the bulk of every digital dollar spent in advertising. But what's been happening is that, you know, when you have a limited amount of ad inventory and all of this demand, the price goes up. And we've seen the price per click steadily rising as the, you know, corporate dollars sort of flow into the system. So as this continues to progress, I've been finding it, at least for my smaller clients, it's more difficult for them to compete in the, you know, pay to play space, because now they're competing with Coca-Cola and Burger King for that same audience. So do you think that there will be a time in which, you know, everything is brought to you, you know, powered by Pepsi or whatever, and the smaller businesses and the smaller agencies sort of get priced out? Or do you think that the internet will, you know, stay true to its disruptive roots, and as those corporate dollars sort of push out the smaller players, that there will still be ways to be viable online, even though more or less things are going pay to play?
I think it's always been the big guys against the little guys. And so just like I would bet that your clients can't afford a Super Bowl ad at the national level, they could afford a cut-in at the local level. And so I think when your clients are smaller, or you're doing this for your own business, the reality is when the budget dollars are smaller, you just have to be scrappier. And you also have to be, one of the things I always find fascinating about the big brands is the waste in their spend. And, you know, you see them in places and you think, why in the world are you there? And so they have so much money that they don't really worry about a few $100,000 here or a few $100,000 there. But the reality is the lion's share of businesses today, that's bigger than their entire budget. And so they do have to care, and they do have to be surgically precise in where they spend their money and how they spend their money. And I also think that quite honestly, that most people buy locally and shop locally and want services, you know, typically within a certain radius of their business. So I still think there are ways with geo-targeting and all the other things that you can do to still spend your dollars in a smart way that gets you in front of the consumers that you want to talk to in a way that is unique to a smaller or niche business.
Awesome. So last question, and I'll let you get back to your day. And I do appreciate you taking the time. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast, but I'm steering it in a very particular direction. And I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it, because in my professional opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean somebody who works in-house at a brand or at an agency. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. Not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 at the end of the year. And broadly speaking, there's sort of three main tracks that people educate themselves, the first of which being to meander the wilds of Google. And while there is some very good information out there, a lot of which is for free, contrary to popular belief, rooting it out does take a little bit of skill. You might land on Convince and Convert. You might end up doing Amway. Like, who knows where that rabbit hole goes? The second way is you can do what I did, which is go back and get a degree in internet marketing. The cons there is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my undergraduate. Plus, it's time consuming. Even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete, which in the digital space is several lifetimes. But by far the most prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best in class practices is through conferences and seminars. The rub there is that even though in aggregate, it's a lot less expensive than getting a degree, you have to have the money up front. So, you know, we just ended March. This is April. And so you had, you know, Social Media Marketing World, and you had South by Southwest. Some of your better conferences are going to cost between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That does not include your flight, your hotel, Uber, eating out for however many days. Once you factor all of that in, you're easily looking at $3,000 to $5,000 out of pocket. And so that can become cost prohibitive very quickly. And, you know, so you sort of have to be careful with that. So I'm trying to crowdsource a way of professionalizing yourself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to borrow against your life insurance policy to attend a conference. So now that I just finished rambling for however long, I asked the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in the brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the skills and experience you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right. You are college freshman broke, Drew. Yep. You have somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Wow. Okay. So if that were the case, I'm a firm believer in, so I think there's merit in all three of the ways that you talked about learning. And I think the best learners actually do all three to a certain degree within their budget. But assuming that I couldn't do any of those, one of my favorite ways to learn is I'm a big proponent of mastermind groups, of surrounding yourself with a small group of people who are good at what they do and learning from them by supporting their efforts and helping them get where they want to go. So watching and mimicking them and also asking them to hold you accountable to get better every day and having them in that sort of informal format teach you what they know that you don't know. So I would seek out, three or four people who, you know, based on my internet connection sitting in my dorm room that I could find and ask them if we could get together once a month for a few hours to talk about the work that we're doing, how we're doing it, what's working, what's not working. And I would learn that way. I'm a firm believer in that it's of incredible value to sit at the feet of masters. And that's not that you have to seek out the Jay Bears of the world, although he's a lovely guy and super smart and probably would be game to do it. Everybody is a master at some aspect of the work that we do. And so, and by the way, you can tell pretty quickly if somebody's not because they're not getting results. So I would seek to create little, think of them as little hives of people that I could hang out with and learn from by just experimenting and trying things and telling them what worked and didn't work. So I'd want to come to those meetings ready to teach, but also ready to learn. And then hopefully over time, I would be able to make enough money that I could begin to seek out some of the other things that you listed earlier. Because again, like I said in the very beginning, you know, if I spoke to earlier, you know, younger Drew, it would be, this is a profession that requires constant learning and education in some fashion or form. So that's what I would do.
There you have it, folks. I hope you've been taking notes because you have just been sitting at the feet of a master. So Drew, this has been tremendous. Please take a moment. Tell us all your social media handles. Tell us about your podcast, Agency Management Institute. Where can we get some more you?
Yeah. So I'm pretty easy to find. I'm pretty much Drew McLellan, which is McLellan everywhere. So Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, all of that. If you want to email me, drew@agencymanagementinstitute.com is probably your best bet. And that's also agencymanagementinstitute.com is probably the URL to start at if you're looking to track me down. So always happy to connect with people and answer questions and learn a little bit about what they do. So be glad to hear from anybody.
Thank you, Drew, for your time. This has been awesome.
Thank you so much for having me. It was great.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.